Sorry. That was bad. That was not spirit-led, by the way. Thanks to Lynn and Heather for all of their hard work. They've been practicing this for about, really since September. So if you have kids that want to be a part of that, I think they'll probably do another session in the new year. So just look out for the mode announcements that will probably come out. And now, let's go to James chapter 5. We're going to read verses 7 through 12 today. So as you're turning there, one more announcement. I've got Vespers. We've got Vespers here tonight in the sanctuary at 6 p.m. We'll just be up here, up on the chancel, and this will be the last one that we have for this year. We'll pick up Vespers in the new year with all of the holidays coming up and travels and things like that. This will be our last Vespers, so come and join us if you are able to tonight at 6. For James chapter 5, we're going to sort, like we've done the last few weeks, we'll read little sections and talk about it, so just keep a bookmark or keep a finger there if you would. But as we're thinking about everything that's come so far, this is the second to last message in the book of James. So Pastor Cindy's going to finish it out next week for us. But thinking about everything that he's talked about so far, James is now pivoting to a conclusion in his letter. And so if you'll remember over the last couple months as we've been going through James, you would probably say that James hasn't sugarcoated much. Would I be right in saying that? He's been very just brutally honest, addressing many issues that the Christians were either being subjected to or they themselves were being or that they were subjecting others to. And so just like a quick recap for some of the issues that James has been talking about so far. Trials and tribulations. He's been talking about temptations, anger, favoritism towards the rich and treating the poor as less than, destructive speech, envy, selfish ambition, fights, quarrels, arrogance, and greed. And so if that's not a list that targets all of us in some place, I don't know what to tell you, but I'll tell you just about every week as we've encountered James, there's been something that I've had to sit with and wrestle with and say, Lord, I need an attitude adjustment in my life. And so what James has in mind here in verses 7 through 12 is really now the reaction of the Christians to all of the things that he has been talking about. The reaction of the Christians to all of the sin, either in their lives or in the sin in the lives of others. Now, can we just be honest for just a moment and say, can we just admit that sometimes our reaction to sin in this world is just as sinful as the sin that we're reacting to? Does that make sense? Can we just be honest and say that sometimes our reaction to sin in the world, other people's sin, is just as sinful as what we're pointing out and calling out as sin? Can we admit that sometimes we are like James and John in Luke 9? If you remember the story, Jesus sent his disciples to go into Samaria to preach and to get things ready. And the citizens of this town in Samaria, they were not hospitable to Jesus. And so they kicked Jesus and his disciples out of town. And so James and John come to Jesus and they say, Jesus, what would you like for us to do in response to this? Shall we call down fire from heaven? Have you ever had like a similar thought? Not exactly thinking that you can call down fire from heaven, but you know, just, Lord, would you maybe have intentions for people who have done you wrong that perhaps wouldn't be the intentions that God would have for them? Don't we sometimes have similar attitudes like James and John to the sin in our world? The problem is you can't put fire out with more fire. And so certainly Christian anger, Christian outrage, Christian anxiety and fear and worry is not the answer to all that ails this world. And so if only James would tell us then what the answer is. If only James would then tell us how we ought to live. And so let's pick up in verses 7 through 9 of the text today. James writes, "Be patient then, brothers and sisters, until the Lord's coming. See how the farmer waits for the land to yield its valuable crop, patiently waiting for the autumn and spring rains. You too, be patient and stand firm, because the Lord's coming is near. Don't grumble against one another, brothers and sisters, or you will be judged. The judge is standing at the door. I found this quote this past week from a commentator named Taylor Matthew. He's got a website called Seeking Our God, and he talks a little bit about sort of the Greek word for patience in this text. And I've got the quote on the screen. This is what Taylor writes. Be patient, and I'm not going to try and pronounce the Greek word up there, comes from a compound of long, makros, and temper, thymos. The idea is to set the timer of one's temper for a long run. Think long. Focus on the final lap in the race of life. Have a long fuse. James urges believers to maintain an attitude of patience while suffering injustices. And we've seen James talk about this in chapter 1 as well, to have an attitude of patience, have a long fuse while suffering injustices. Having a short fuse, my friends, is not a fruit of the Spirit. Patience is a fruit of the Spirit. And so the example that James gives us of patience is that of a farmer. How many farmers, how many gardeners do we have in the place today? Farmers and gardeners. You know what it takes to grow. You know the rhythms of that. And you know a big part of what you do is patience. Now, there is a lot that you can do, right? There's a lot that you should do. Till and fertilize and plant and maybe spread pesticides. Maintain your equipment. But making it rain at the right time, has anyone figured out how to do that? Making the sun shine when you need it to shine, has anyone figured that out? Avoiding inclement weather, all of those things are not up to the farmer. And so one of the most humbling things for us to admit is that there are some things that are just out of our control. There are just some things that are out of our control, but that's not good for our self-esteem, and so we would rather not admit that to ourselves. You can only do what you can do, but then you're going to have to trust God in the days where there's little growth. You're going to have to trust God in the days where there's little change, where there's minimal results. And even in difficulty and disaster, remember that God is at work. That's what James is calling for us to remember, is that even in the days of difficulty and disaster, God is at work. And so during the days of trial and tribulation, we have hope because we remember that Jesus is King and his kingdom is even nearer today than what it was yesterday. Even in the days when we face great temptations, the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead lives within you. And so when you face temptations that seem too great, remember you are not facing those temptations alone. There are three times here in two verses that James mentions either the Lord's coming or the Lord's nearness. In verse 8, he says, be patient, have a long fuse, because, and here's the kicker, be patient because the Lord's coming is near. In verse 9, he says, the judge is standing at the door. Be patient. Have a long fuse because the Lord's coming is near and the judge is standing at the door. So we're talking about today growing up in hope. What is the hope of our broken world? What is your hope in this broken world? I don't know about you, but for me, it's Christ will come again. That's my hope in this broken world. Christ will come again. His kingdom is from everlasting to everlasting. The hope of the world, my hope of the world, isn't in the preservation of our democratic system. My hope is not in a free enterprise system. It's not in socialism or communism. It's not in the elephant or the donkey, Republican or Democrat. Where is your hope today? Is it in King Jesus, or is it something man-made? You see, the present world and the present age that we live in will pass away. It's gonna go away. It's fading away day by day. Do you sense that? Do you sense that the end is somewhere in the future? We don't know when it's gonna be, and I'm not gonna throw out dates, but we know that history is going to come to a conclusion. And so if it feels like things are coming to a close, don't fret, but lift up your eyes to the mountain from where your help comes from. And this, my friends, has been the hope of Christians through all the centuries. And even today, Christians in other parts of the world, Christians who are facing severe trials and tribulations, their hope, what gets them up today, is that Jesus is King, that Jesus is Lord, that His kingdom is in charge. His kingdom rules and reigns today and will rule and reign for eternity. The judge is at the door. And so we can put down our gavels. We can pray for our enemies and love sacrificially, just as Jesus taught us to. We talked last week about growing in trust. We can have hope if we trust in the power of Jesus and His kingdom. And so the question that I have for myself and the question for you is, do you trust that Jesus will have the last word? And if you trust that Jesus will have the last word, then let's take a deep breath this morning. Let's just breathe in and breathe out. Doesn't that feel good to trust that Jesus is going to have the last word no matter what things look like right now? As an example of those who trusted that God would have the last word, then James goes on to write in verses 10 through 11. Here's his examples. He says, brothers and sisters, as an example of patience in the face of suffering, take the prophets who spoke in the name of the Lord. As you know, we count as blessed those who have persevered. You have heard of Job's perseverance and have seen what the Lord finally brought about. The Lord is full of compassion and mercy. Can you imagine how unsatisfying a job of being a prophet would have been? When you think about the prophets of the Old Testament, how unsatisfying of a job that might have been to have the job where you're the messenger, and you all know what happens to the messenger, right? The messenger gets killed. That probably, I would say that moniker probably comes from the prophets of the Old Testament, where they're just going and they say, listen, God has a word for you. He wants to bless you, but because of your sin, you're going to face some tough times. And so the prophets went with a message, and nobody listened to the message. And then the people just doubled down on their sin and their rebellion. And then they kicked the prophets out of town, and they beat them, and they stoned them. Sounds like a horrible thing, doesn't it? And so James, when he's talking about patience, having a long fuse in the midst of suffering, he points to the prophets. He says, look at them. And then James goes on, and just briefly, he talks about Job in passing. The book of Job. How many of you read the book of Job? Read through the, you know what Job is about. He just mentions Job. Now, Job is the character in the scriptures in the Old Testament who lost his wife. He lost his children. He lost his livestock. He lost his home. Job had some friends that came to him with some terrible advice about what he should believe about God and what he should believe about himself. But in the end, what Job did right is that he trusted that God would have the last word. Even in the midst of horrific tragedy in his life, and there's a moment in chapter 1, right after Job's children were killed, they were all in a house together, and the roof of the house collapsed, look at Job's words here in Job chapter 1, verses 20 through 21. At this, Job got up and tore his robe, and he shaved his head, which, by the way, is not a bad look, right? Job became a baldy, so that's good. Then he fell to the ground in worship. His kids were just killed. He lamented, he mourned, he cried, but he fell to the ground in worship and said, "Naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked I will depart. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. May the name of the Lord be praised." Where is your hope? Is your hope in your last word? Or is your hope in the one who is the judge, who is standing at the door? Let's take a deep breath again. Let's breathe in. Let's breathe out. Finally, James writes in verse 12, "Above all, my brothers and sisters, do not swear by heaven or by earth or by anything else. All you need to say is a simple yes or no, otherwise you will be condemned." Friends, if our hope is centered in our own efforts and power, then it will be reflected by our oaths and promises and fancy speech that in the end will really come to very little. If our hope is in us, then we're going to put a lot of weight in our own oaths and words and promises, our own actions. A simple yes or no is enough if your hope is in the coming of Jesus Christ. Now, over the course of the next year, you know what's coming up in about a year, right? A little bit less than a year. We're going to hear politicians who are going to make oaths, who are going to make promises, who are going to have convincing speeches, and we're going to hear the same things over and over again from these politicians. Let's take a deep breath in. Yeah, right. We can handle this, right? We're going to hear the same things over and over again from the politicians and from pastors, from social media personalities and podcast hosts and voices on the radio who have a lot of money to gain from peddling fear and anxiety. We're going to be led to believe that our side must win. We're going to be led to believe that if one side wins, then God is in control, then God is good, that God is king, that Jesus is king. But if the other side wins, then all hell is going to break loose. We're going to be tempted to believe all of these things over the next year. But beloved, this is my hope for us. If our ultimate hope is in anything other than the power of God, then we will live this life with a short fuse. And we will believe any message from anybody else, whether politics, religion, socially, that will encourage us to live life with a short fuse if our ultimate hope is not in the power of God and the kingdom and the kingdom's reign in this world, in this age, and in the age to come. And so as we think about this today, here's a gospel to go for you, a Psalm chapter 20, verse 7, that I think this is one that I go to often, and it spoke to me this week. "Some trust in chariots and some in horses, but we trust in the name of the Lord our God." If you trust in the ultimate power of God and His kingdom, then my friends, you can live with peace and you can live with hope. And so, beloved children of God, one more time, deep breath in and deep breath out. The judge is standing at the door, and Jesus is Lord. Amen. Amen. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you just for reminders. Simple reminders. Thank you.